Good morning and welcome to Regenerate 2014. We're thrilled to have you all here. People will be coming and going throughout the day. One thing that we're really pleased about is the participation from Jackson Community College, or Jackson College, Adrian College, and Siena Heights University. A good number of students probably got up a little earlier today than they normally do on a Thursday, and we appreciate your being here for the day. We have wonderful speakers throughout the day. We have great exhibitors, lots of great business-to-business information for students. There may be even potential employment information down the road. So take your time and talk to the people who are out on the floor. This program wouldn't be possible without our sponsors. And if you're here, if you could just stand up and be recognized. South Central Michigan Works, Frontier Communications, TLC Community Credit Union, Lenaway Now, D&P Communications, Next Step, and the Sage Foundation. Please join me in thanking all of these businesses. The purpose of today is for you to listen and learn, to be inspired and motivated, to get new ideas, to find new ways to look at old ideas that you may have had, to help you ultimately live your dream and make it happen. Our first speaker this morning is Ken Johnson. Ken is the CEO and president of the Grand Legacy Corporation.
In 1981, he created the Phase 10 card game in his living room. How many of you play Phase 10? Very good. In 2012, he celebrated Phase 10's 30th anniversary and was nominated for a Taggy Award, the Oscar of the toy and game industry. He currently owns two other businesses and has been a guest speaker at inventor clubs across the country, providing resources and support for inventors. Ken will highlight how successful people in business think beyond the obstacles and find their way to success. He'll discuss his entrepreneurial journey from playing board games in his parents' living room to creating Phase 10, a game that's now played by millions across the country. Please join me in welcoming Ken Johnson.
Well, thank you. I appreciate the introduction. And I want to start off by saying I'm not a professional speaker. I'm just an entrepreneur and a regular guy. And I want to tell you my story so that you can appreciate what I think is necessary or what helped me to become successful as an inventor and an entrepreneur. I was going to ask the question that our gracious Anne asked you, how many of you have heard of Phase 10 before today or before this event? Wow, that's more than I would have normally seen. Typically, I have 15-20% of the audience. It looked like about half of you have heard of Phase 10. Does anyone know the number one card game in the world? Uno. Uno is number one. Phase 10 is number two, and it's sold worldwide, and the funny thing is that most people have never heard of it. So I call it the most popular card game you've never heard of. 30 plus years, I hate to admit that, but it's actually 30 plus years, and kind of gave you the story there. 2 years ago, we celebrated Phase 10's 30th anniversary. The first shipment went out August 10th, 1982. Now, I was already 3 years or so into the game business on August 10th, 1982. I started somewhere around 1979. I was about 19 years old. And I didn't start my company in my parents' living room. It was actually in their basement. The living room was much more plush. The basement was your typical basement. And I decided, after working about a year at Ford Motor Company, and there's nothing wrong with that, But I worked at Ford Motor Company, and I did not want to work for someone else the rest of my life. So at 19, I started to think, well, what can I do to start a business? What kind of business can I start? What do I like doing? So I thought about that for a while, and I came up with what I thought was a brilliant idea. I'll start a game manufacturing company. So then I thought, okay, I love playing games. What game can I invent or create? And after thinking for a short period of time, by the way, about this, what game should I create, I instantly thought, well, why don't I start publishing the game that my brother and sister and I played and actually created and played among ourselves for about 7 years, since I was about 12. So the first game I invented, I was actually 12 years old. And it was a board game, a baseball board game. Now this game required the use of four dies or dice, and the game was called Dice Baseball, and you take the four dice and you throw them, and you count the total on the dice, and then you would, we had a chart we created, and you would interpret what the throw meant. So if you rolled an 18, for instance, it might be a single. If you rolled a 24, it might be a home run. If you rolled a six, it might be an out. You get the idea. Now, my brother, sister, and I, we played this game for about 7 years. We loved it. We thought it was the greatest game. So I thought, I'm going to start my game company with that game. So what I did was I went first to Mattel, and actually it was Parker Brothers, Hasbro, Milton Bradley, all the game companies you've heard of, people that produce Monopoly, Clue, those games. I approached them and asked them if they would like to license this baseball board game. And they all said no. And so quickly I realized, okay, that's not going to work, licensing. And by the way, the reason they all said no is the same reason they say no today, is they don't take inventions, new game ideas from independent, unheard of, unproven game designers. That was true 30 plus years ago, that's true today. So if I sent them the game, they told me they would just send it back without reviewing it. And so I realized that's not going to work. What can I do? Well, long story short, I decided I'm going to publish this game myself. So after a couple of years of trial and error, trying to find out how to do this, how do I get boxes made, where do I purchase dice and so forth, I stumbled upon a gentleman in Chicago who became a mentor and showed me exactly how to publish a board game. He showed me how to find manufacturers to produce all the parts, how to assemble them, the type of machines I would need to do the shrink wrapping and so forth. So I bought the necessary equipment, I purchased all the components, and we assembled those games, those first few hundred games, or a couple thousand I guess it was, in my parents' basement in Detroit. Now again, I'm about 19, 20 years old at this time. No business experience. It was the first business I tried to run. Did not attend college, and through trial and error and reading a few books, I figured this out after a couple of years. I published those first few hundred games, and we tried selling them to the retailers around the area. None of them would buy them, and I decided to go to Kmart. Kmart's world headquarters is in Troy, Michigan. I grew up in Detroit. Troy is about 5 miles north of where I lived. So it seemed like the logical place to go. So I went to the headquarters. Actually, I called them first. I called the headquarters and I said, okay, who's the person that buys the board games for Kmart? They gave me the gentleman's name and number, and I called him. And back then, you can call and actually get people on the phone, right? Today, you can't. So I actually called and got Mr. Christensen on the phone, and said, look, Mr. Christensen, and again, I don't know anything about business. I'm just a guy trying to get my games on the market. I said, Mr. Christensen, I'd love to present my board game to Kmart. I think it's the greatest game you've ever heard of, you've ever seen. It's better than Monopoly. You're going to love it. Can I bring it and show it to you? He said, no, why don't you put it in the mail, send it to me, and I'll review it and get back to you. Well, at 19, I thought, I don't know. He's going to look at this game, if he even looks at it, and he's just going to put it aside, because after all, their biggest customers or suppliers are Parker Brothers, Milton Bradley, Coleco, all those companies of that time. He's not going to review my game. So instantly I said, well, Mr. Christensen, look, I'm just a few miles away. All I need is 15 minutes of your time. Can I just come by and show it to you? He said, oh, okay. So I go to his office on the date of the appointment. And this is about September of 19, wow, when was it, 1980? Yeah, 1980. And so I go to his office, I present the game to him, and again, I don't know anything about it. I don't know that I'm supposed to have a sales sheet. I don't know that I need specifications for freight, case pack, all these other things. I don't know any of this. I'm just a kid trying to get my games on the market. So I go there and I just show him. All I walk in with is one of the samples. I show it to him. He says, well, I tell you what, the game sounds interesting, but I don't do my game buying for Christmas the following year. I don't do that until after Toy Fair, which is in February of, at that point, it would have been 1981. And of course, I don't know any of this stuff. I don't know what Toy Fair is. I don't know the buying cycles, but I'm getting a quick education. So he says, I said, well, look, Mr. Christensen, can I come back after Toy Fair, which is about 6 months from that time? Can I come back and show you the game? At that point, he says, sure. He gives me an appointment for 6-7 months later, and I go back. When I go back the second time, he's already told me, look, when you come back the second time, have a sell sheet, and he gave me an example, have a packing sheet. He gave me an example of what one should look like. Bring all this information. I said, great. So during that 6-7 month period, I prepared all these documents he wanted, and I go back. And when I go back, I have everything I need. I show him the game, and he says, okay, I will try the game, and we'll put it in our entire chain. And at that time, they had, I don't know, a couple thousand stores. And by the way, Kmart then was what Walmart is today. Okay, it was the biggest retailer in the country. Between Kmart and Sears, biggest retailer. So they gave me a standing order first time. Incredible. So I'm excited. He tells me, though, oh, by the way, why don't you have another company produce the game for you? Because I'm not so sure you're ready at 19, 20 years old to handle the volume that we're going to bring to you. So you need to find a licensee. Now, again, I'm new, I'm green. I don't even know what a licensee is. So he explains it to me. He says, that's another company that will manufacture the game for you under a license. It's like a rental agreement or a lease agreement. They'll do it under a license, and they'll pay you royalties. So you don't really have to do anything. Just sign the license agreement. They'll do everything. He suspected I didn't have the wherewithal, the financial wherewithal and otherwise to do this, and he was right. So I said, okay, great. I don't know where to start with that, though. He said, okay, well, here's what you'll do. Here's what I'll do. I'll give you a name of two or three companies, and you contact them, and they'll give you a license deal. So I called one of the companies. It was Warm Paper Products. They were located in Lafayette, Indiana. I called them up and said, look, I'd like to see if you're interested in doing a license deal on my dice baseball board game. And the gentleman said, I don't know, we don't know if we want to do a license deal because, you know, we don't know you, we don't know the game, and we don't want to put our marketing efforts behind a product that's unproven and we got to go sell it to retailers. Then I mentioned, but wait a minute, Kmart, George Christensen said he'll buy them nationwide. All I need is you to manufacture them. And his I heard silence for a minute. He says, wait a minute, you got Kmart to give you an order? I said, yes. He said, okay, come on down. So I drove down to Lafayette, went and met with them, and inside of a week we had a license deal, and they did all the manufacturing for my game, the dice baseball game, and it hit the market in the fall of 1981, about 6 months after that meeting with Mr. Christensen. So I'm on my way. I've got a license deal. I'm going to make, I think at this point, millions of dollars, and all I got to do is go to the mailbox and pick up checks every quarter. Well, there was a problem. What was the problem? The game didn't sell very well. We got it on the shelf, Kmart, nationwide, very few sales. And I was very disappointed. And oh, by the way, so was Mr. Christensen. So he calls me up later that year, sometime after Christmas, and says, Ken, the game's not selling very well. You know, we're going to have to pull it from our line. So I was pretty disappointed, so was he, and I said, okay, Mr. Christensen, but wait a minute, I've got another game for you. He says, okay, Ken, I don't know, your first game didn't sell very well, I don't know if we should do this. I said, but wait a minute, Mr. Christensen, you're going to love this game. It's called Phase 10. He says, okay, it's called Phase 10. I said, but wait a minute, it's a great game, it's a card game, it's based on Rummy. Card games are hot right now. In fact, Uno was peaking at that point, 1982. They sold about 12 million games that year, which at that point was phenomenal. And by the way, you may not know this, the typical game, if it's successful, sells about 100, 200,000 pieces a year. May not sound like a lot to you, but that's a lot in the game business. Uno was selling about 10 to 12 million games worldwide. Phenomenal success. So I said, this card game is going to be big. It's going to rival Uno. And he laughed and said, okay, Ken, we'll see. Why don't you come in and show it to me? And just to backtrack for a minute, I tracked the sales of Dice Baseball at Kmart, and I knew it wasn't selling. And I figured this out in about October or November, a few months after shipping. And I said, I got a problem. So I need to start working on another game. So I, by then, had moved out of my parents' house. I was living in an apartment. And I sat in my bedroom and came up with Phase 10. Because I saw the success of Uno, and I said, I got to come up with a card game. Card games are hot. I got to do this. So it took me a few days, but I came up with Phase 10. And that's when I decided to show it to Mr. Christensen. So I go to his office on the appointment date, and I show him Phase 10. Now, I've gotten an education from him because he told me what documents I need. I had the sales sheet, the case pack. I had all this figured out. I look like a professional at this point. I give him everything he needs, and I said, Mr. Christensen, I want to manufacture this game myself. I don't want to do a license deal, and I can do this. Trust me. He said, okay, Ken, here's what we'll do. I will give you 20 stores in the Metro Detroit area on a one-time sale basis, and then we'll take it from there. I said, okay, that's fine. And he said, oh, by the way, you may want to talk to the people at Meijer. At the time, they were called Meijer Thrifty Acres. Now they're just Meijer. He said, you may want to talk to the people at Meijer and see if they'll buy it. So he actually gave me the phone number of the buyer at Meijer. And I call them up. They're in Grand Rapids. I drive over there and show the buyer at Meijer. And he says, okay, Ken. At that point, they had 60 stores. He said, we'll buy it. I'm thinking, I'm on a roll now. I've got two retailers. I've shown it twice. I'm batting 1,000. This is going to be big. So they both want their shipments about August of 1982. And now I know how to buy components because I'd gotten that education from this other gentleman. And I go buy the card decks from a company in Missouri. I get the instructions printed from a local printer, the tuck boxes. This is the current version of Phase 10. The box it comes in, they're called tuck boxes. And so I buy the tuck boxes from a printer in northern Michigan. And all these components come to my parents' house. And I invite some of my high school friends over. And we assemble the first couple of thousand games in my folks' basement. And We were running late getting them together because the tuck boxes came in kind of late, so we worked very hard. And literally, my father and I threw the boxes in the back of our station wagon, and we hauled over to the UPS location. They didn't have UPS stores in. You had to go to their actual distribution facility. And we drove, it was at the airport, we drove there and made it just in time to get the shipment out on the day it needed to be shipped. And so I went to Meijer and went to Kmart. So what I did then was I tracked those 20 stores. I'd go into each of those stores weekly and count how many games were on the shelf to see how it was doing. And, oh, by the way, my friend said to me, you know, Ken, since you know where all 20 of these stores are, why don't we do this? We'll go to those stores and we'll buy the games. We'll buy a couple each day and make it look like it's selling really good. And I thought for a minute, and I said, you know, it will appear to be selling very well, but I don't want to do that. And I said, the reason I don't want to do that is I won't know if it's selling. And I want to really have a business. I don't want to just fool Kmart for a year and they eventually find out, okay? I want a business. So let's see if it's really selling. So I went and tracked the stores, and I had the clipboard, and I'd go into stores every week and check off and see how many games they were selling. And I noticed they were selling a few every day or a few every week at the rate that would be approved by Kmart. So after a month or two, I went back to Mr. Christensen and I said, okay, we're doing pretty good. We're selling through. Let's expand. Let's go nationwide. He said, hold on. I'll give you another 50 stores in Chicago. So he gives me another 50 stores. I get my friends together. We assemble and manufacture, assemble the games. We ship them out to Chicago. Now, I didn't drive to Chicago every week to count the movement of the games. I just sat back to see what happened. And about 6 months later, he called me and said, Ken, they're moving pretty well. Why don't you come into my office? So I go to his office. I'm thinking, this is it. I'm going to get the big order here. I'm going to get national distribution at Kmart. Instead, he gives me 800 stores nationwide, one-time sale. One-time sale means you ship it to the store. They're not obligated to reorder. It's just there. When they sell out, you're done. So I said, okay, that's better than nothing. Again, I get my high school friends together. I buy all the components. We assemble them in my folks' basement, ship them out. 800 stores. Now, at this point, Mr. Christensen and I are starting to get calls and letters, not just from people in the U.S., but from around the world. And I'm thinking, okay, I don't know how big this is, but I just know this is pretty unusual. It seems odd. I'm getting letters from people in Germany, the U.K., Canada, Australia, Libya. We were at war with them at the time. I'm getting letters from people in Libya. I'm thinking, what does this mean? So I'm telling him, he's telling me, and we're both getting pretty excited. And so he says, okay, Ken, I'm going to give you national distribution on a basic stock listing, which means it's going to be in all the stores all the time. So at this point, I'm on my way. And I thought, at one point, I'm overwhelmed. How am I going to finance all of this? And on the other hand, I'm very excited because now I think I've got a real business and I'm going to go from Kmart to Sears to JCPenney to Walmart, which had about 300 stores, mostly in the South, every retailer. Well, I called on all those other retailers. None of them would buy Phase 10 because, in their view, they wanted to wait and see how I did at Kmart. So for the first several years, I only had Kmart and Meijer and a few mom-and-pop stores around the country and a few places in Canada. But it went on to get bigger and bigger, and eventually I started licensing Phase 10 to a manufacturer in Indiana. They were called Fundex, and they handled all my distribution nationwide. After I did it for about 7 years, they took over distribution. I got involved in another business. That other business was telecommunications, resale. We would buy AT&T and Sprint long-distance services in bulk and then resell them to small businesses around the country at a discount for them. Example is, we would, for $1 million a month commitment, we would get a rate of 12 cents a minute. Now, again, this is 25 years ago. The average business was paying somewhere around 35, 36 cents a minute for long distance service. We'd buy it at 12 because we made this $1 million a month commitment, and we would sell it to businesses for 24 cents a minute. They got a 33% savings, and we got 100% markup or 50% margin. And it was a great business, because once we had our acquisition costs recovered, everything was just pretty much gravy after that. So it was a great business, and I was in that business for about 15 years. So when I started licensing, that's what I got into. Now, just to give you an example of, hitting the wrong button here. This is the original version of Phase 10. Mattel is my licensee today. In 2010, I switched from Fundex to Mattel. Most of you, I'm sure, have heard of Mattel, largest toy company in the world. They're known mostly for Barbie and Hot Wheels, but they also have games, and they acquire their games that are brands that are fully established. They'd rather pay millions of dollars to acquire a brand that's been established already than to build one themselves. So after we'd been in the business for 28 years, they came to me and said, Ken, we want to acquire the rights to Phase 10. And long story short, we transferred the license from Fundex to Mattel. They call themselves the makers of Uno. They wanted the number two selling card game. They already had the number one and the number three. Does anyone have any idea what number three is? I bet no one knows this. No hands. I was right.
Is it Skippo?
You're right, Skippo. Give her a hand. I've never had anyone know that. It's Skippo. Anybody played Skippo? Okay, good. A lot of hands out there for that. So they wanted number two to go with number one and number three. So they acquired the license to Phase 10 in 2010. I negotiated that license agreement, and I'm very happy working with them. And it's funny, I was just looking at my email before I came up, and they sent me their remittance form indicating what my royalty is going to be due. It's due November 15th, and they showed me how much I'm getting. So it's nice working with them. They're a very good company, and they pay on time. My previous company did not. They pay on time. So Phase 10 is the core product, created in 1982. In 2000, I think it was 2000, I created Phase 10 Masters. Anybody played Phase 10 Masters? Okay, just looks like one hand. Phase 10 Masters, in my view, is the best of the entire line. If you play Phase 10, I think most of you have, you know you have to complete 10 phases in a specific order, and you can't move to the next until you completed the one you're working on, right? And the game dictates which phase you're working on in that order. In the Master's Edition, you actually get to choose. You have the same 10 phases, but you get to choose in the order in which you're going to complete them. And you can make that choice after you see your hand. So if you play Phase 10, you know that, okay, you're looking at your hand, and you say, I got a perfect hand for a run of 9, for instance, which is Phase 6. And so you can choose that phase, complete it. Now you eliminate it from your choices, and you have 9 phases left to complete. So on the next hand, maybe you have a perfect hand for Phase 7, which most of you know is the hardest one to complete. Anybody know that one? What's Phase 7? No, that's 8. Anybody know? The hardest one to complete is Phase 7. It's 2 sets of 4. And so if your hand dictates that you have a good chance of getting 2 sets of 4, you choose that phase, and once you complete it, you eliminate it from your choices. So that's why I personally like Masters a great deal. And I had a conversation with Mattel this week, and they're intending to boost the distribution of Masters. All these games are available worldwide. Our second biggest market behind the U.S. is actually Germany. Phase 10, the original, is the number one card game in Germany. We sell more than Uno, which I'm very happy about, and hoping we eventually get that way in the U.S. So this is Masters. I created that myself in about 2000. Twist was introduced in 2009. Anybody play Twist? No Twist hands, okay. Twist is the board game version, this is the board here, of the card game. And in the board game version, the object is to complete the 10 phases, but you get to skip phases based on your movement around the board. So it's actually much faster to play. I designed it to be faster because the only complaint we have about the original game is that it can take a while to play. And the reason for that is usually people are talking while they're playing. If you play with people that are just playing the game, you can finish it in an hour. But if you're talking, it can take 3 hours, which is great for the social environment. That's what games are all about, right? You have people, maybe you're an adult, there's a couple, husband and wife or what have you, and they invite another couple over for a dinner party, and after that, they play Phase 10. They're not likely to play Uno. You wouldn't play Uno with another couple, would you? You play with a kid. Some do, I guess, but on a camping trip, but not after a dinner party. You play Phase 10. You got it? Everybody understand? Okay. So Phase 10, Phase 10 Masters, Twist. In 1994, Phase 10 Dice was created. And here's the beautiful part about being a license, an intellectual property owner, and a license, licensor. The beautiful part is other people can create products for you, and you get paid. Right? Doesn't that sound good? This dice version was actually created by a couple of gentlemen in Ann Arbor, a company called Random Games. That's all they do is create games off of popular brands. They have a very good business doing that, and they created the Phase 10 dice game. But because it's called Phase 10, and it's based off the concepts and copyright of Phase 10, Mattel has to pay me. So I like that. I can just sit back, let others create games. They have to get my approval to use my name and my basic intellectual property, and I get paid. So that's great. Now here's Phase 10 kids. As you can see, there's, who's that? Thor, Spider-Man, Hulk is back there somewhere, and a few other action heroes. So we use Marvel characters for the kids version of Phase 10. As you can see, this is back when Fundex was producing it, and it's no longer available right now in the U.S. Kids is available in Germany, all over Europe, but not here in the U.S. because of licensing issues. And so, again, in this conversation I had last week or earlier this week, whenever it was with Mattel, we're going to start doing Phase 10 kids in the U.S. in 2016, and they're going to use some of the licensed characters they have, like, of course, Barbie, and Disney characters, that sort of thing. So I'm looking forward to that. Now, we also have apps. So if you haven't downloaded the app, it's absolutely free for the first three phases. If you want to play a complete game, you have to pay $1.99, and that's not much. Cup of coffee, right? So we do very well. Phase 10, the app, is the number, and it fluctuates from week to week, but it's number 2 in Google Play, and it's number 4 on the iPhone, the Apple's stuff. So we're happy about that. This is Phase 10 in Walmart store. If you go to Walmart, you'll see it pretty much displayed this way. It's usually near Uno and somewhere near Skippo. Or should I say Skippo is somewhere near Phase 10. So they're usually right there together. This is another popular game. You can barely see the corner of it. Anybody know this? Apples to apples. Mattel acquired the license for Apples. I know the gentleman that owns the intellectual property rights to Apples to Apples. He lives out west. And Mattel acquired that license in 2007. And they've done very well with it. And so has he, Matt. He makes a very good royalty as a result of Apples to Apples. So can you make money as an inventor slash entrepreneur? Of course. Anybody recognize this device? Super Soaker, that's right. Anybody know this gentleman? No, it's like me. Nobody knows who I am. Here's the funny thing. We sell so many games, and he sells far more Super Soakers. We sell so many games a year that if I were in the music business, selling the number of games we sell, everybody would know who I am, because we sell millions of games every year. But game inventors, most popular games you've played are people like me, independent game developers who are unknown by the general public. The gentleman who created Trivial Pursuit make millions of dollars per year. Nobody knows who they are. Uno was created by a barber in Ohio back in 1971-72. He sold them out of the trunk of his car and in his barber shop for the first couple years, and then eventually got them to a company called International Games, who made it really blow up. And from there, Mattel acquired the intellectual property, not just the license that they have from me and, say, Matt from Apples to Apples. They acquired everything, the intellectual property and all the distribution rights. And no one knew the barber. Scrabble, you've all played Scrabble, right? You certainly heard of it. Scrabble, invented by an older gentleman named Butts. I think his name was Edwin Butts. He created it as an elderly gentleman, and it went huge, and it's still a very big seller today. So most games that are popular are created by individual inventors, and then they're acquired by the big companies. Same thing here with Lonnie Johnson. Now, this gentleman is a rocket scientist, really a rocket scientist, engineer down in Atlanta. And he set out to create some kind of, in all his creative stuff, he has a whole lab, a number of people working for him, and they create gadgets and gizmos and things for various industries. And they were going to create something that was going to be used in some other application, I don't remember what, but some other application. And in creating that, they realized that this device would squirt water a great distance. The old squirt guns, you press it with your finger and it goes 10 feet or 5 feet and that was it. Well, this, maybe not 10 feet, maybe just a couple feet, right? You remember those old squirt guns. Well, this device would pump water a much greater distance. So he said, I'm going to make a toy out of it. So he created this toy, not necessarily this particular one, but he created this toy, called it the Super Soaker. Long story short, Hasbro owns the rights to the Super Soaker, and they paid Lonnie a royalty. He makes a lot of money in royalties. And I'm gonna give you an example. So they pay him every year, quarterly, on the Super Soaker. And his license agreement dictated that whenever they use that device, that mechanism that would squirt water in any application, whether it was squirting water or anything else, they had to pay him. Well, somehow Hasbro forgot that. They paid him for the Super Soaker, but the current device that also uses the same mechanics is something you've all seen. It's the, that gun that shoots those darts, Nerf guns? You've seen those, right? Same device, same mechanism behind it. So Hasbro said, Lonnie said to them last year, wait a minute, guys, you owe me for a royalty on all those Nerf guns you've sold over the last, I guess it was 10 years or so. And they said, nah, we don't think so. He said, yes, you do, and he filed a lawsuit. Well, during the mediation portion of the litigation, in fact, I don't think it even went that far, an arbitration hearing or something, Hasbro quickly back down and said, okay, you're right, we owe you the money. And they got together and they tabulated how much they owed him from back royalties on the Nerf guns alone. And the total, I'm glad you're all sitting down, the total they decided to pay him was $73 million. And now they continue to pay him going forward. So can you make money as an inventor? Yes, Lonnie proves you can. So I mentioned that I started as a game developer, manufacturer. Then I went into the long-distance resale business, did that for about 15 years. I sold the company I built. We had 200 employees. I had 150 in Metro Detroit and 50 in Las Vegas. Why Las Vegas, you ask? Well, it's because I liked the warm weather, and I thought, if I'm going to leave Michigan in the wintertime, where do I want to go? Somewhere warm. So I go to Vegas. I set up an office there, and we have 50 employees. And I spent 2 weeks in Michigan, 2 weeks in Vegas before I got married. Once I got married, I decided to sell. Actually, I got an unsolicited offer for my operation in Michigan, so I sold it. I figured, okay, we're going to settle in Las Vegas. And 6 weeks later, I get an offer for the one in Vegas, and I sell that business. So I find myself in Vegas, nothing to do, and we moved to Scottsdale, Arizona, and then I spent 4 years there doing consulting work to other telecommunication companies. I did that for about 4 years, and then I moved to Indianapolis. I'm from Michigan, by the way. I told you that. Grew up in my folks' home in Detroit, made my games in the basement initially. We go from Scottsdale to Indianapolis. I start a logistics company, operate that company for 4 years. My wife and I have a son. He's 8 years old now. And we decide when he's one to move back here to Michigan. So here we are. And now I spend my time managing my licensees and also developing other businesses. And I have a business now that we develop apps. I don't know if I mentioned, I did mention that we have the Phase 10 app. And I'm developing an app now for one of my other games. It's a trivia game. And this app will be different from most trivia game apps in that you will earn rewards as you play the game, much like you do with airline miles and that sort of thing. You'll earn rewards. And as you accumulate points, you can redeem them for Target gift cards, Amazon, you name it, Starbucks. And so it gives you something to go to shoot for as you're playing the game beyond just beating your friends. So that's what we're working on now. But I think there's a formula for success in business. I call it success by thought, as you can see here. That's what I call the formula. And I think the formula consists of a burning desire. When I was starting with my game company, I had this desire to get away from working for someone else and have my own business. And that desire was so strong that when I went through hurdles and obstacles, I continued to push forward. As I mentioned before, my first game failed. And my friends said, hey, you can't make money building a game company. You can't sell games. Basically, you don't know what you're doing. And it's not going to work. And I started to have a little bit of self-doubt, but that burning desire to have a business and do what I loved, which was creating and playing games, got me over that hurdle. And I continued to push forward, came up with Phase 10. It became a hit, and I created several other games since, such as I mentioned the trivia game. I've had other card games and a couple of other board games, Phase 10 being the big seller. The other games are more mediocre and average, and many of them are no longer available. So that burning desire pushed me through those difficult times. And so when I talk to, I'm a counselor at SCORE, as I mentioned to the gentleman who's representing SCORE today. I've been a SCORE counselor for about 12, 13 years. And I always tell people that come in who are looking for business advice, whatever that might be in the specific area. It could be accounting, it could be HR, it could be startup issues, that you have to really desire that outcome, that goal, to be a self-employed, to be a business owner. It's not easy. And those of you who are in business, you know this. It's not easy, but that desire has to be strong enough to get you through those difficult times, those hurdles, those obstacles that will inevitably rear their ugly head. You have to be able to jump over those, and that desire must be there. It must be strong enough to get you past those difficult times. So that's step one of the formula. You have to have the desire. Secondly, you also need to believe that you can do it. Believe you can be successful. Again, when I went to the buyer at Kmart, as I indicated, I didn't know anything about the game business. I thought I knew about creating games. I didn't know much about the business side. Again, I didn't even know what a sell sheet was. I didn't know what a specification sheet was. The buyer helped me with that. But one thing I did know is that I believed I could do it. I believed I could make this work. At one point, I decided to hire sales reps when I was doing the manufacturing. And the first gentleman I called was the previous representative for Uno. And he had left Uno, and he was looking for another game to represent. We got together, and he was excited because he saw all these letters I was getting from around the world. He saw that Kmart was selling it nationwide. And he said, "Ken, I'd love to represent you." And he started asking me questions. He said, "How did you get the buyer to buy your game?" He was just fascinated. "You know, what made you think you could do that? You know, you're a young person, 19, 20 years old. How did you do that?" I said, "I don't know. I just thought I could do this. Why not?" I believed. So I think that if you believe in what you're doing and you believe in yourself, you can get past the difficulties and not let anyone tell you you can't. What pushed me, one part of the burning desire and the belief was when people told me, "You can't do this." I literally had friends sit down and say, "You can't do this." And first thing that comes to mind for me is when someone tells you you can't do it, it's because they think they can't do it. And so since they think they can't do it, they project that on you. So I wanted to prove people wrong, prove to them that I could do this. So my encouragement to individuals in startup mode or in business, however long you've been operating, is to continue to believe in what you're doing. Third, take action. Take it daily. Do something to advance your business on a daily basis. Determination, that's all a part of that burning desire. Continue to push forward. Continue to believe and be determined to get around those hurdles and obstacles. One of the difficulties I faced in the early days of the business, as I indicated, when the buyer gave me the national listing for Kmart for phase 10, he and I were concerned about my resources to produce the game. And I tried not to let on to him that I didn't have the money to get this going. But I had the desire. So I figured, I'll figure that out later. Let's just give me the order. He did. And the problem I had was, okay, I need to produce tens of thousands of games at a cost. My initial order was for $50,000. And I'd never seen $50,000 before. It was like a million to me back then, okay? So $50,000. And I thought, well, where am I going to get the money? My family doesn't have that kind of money. I went to the bank, and the banker said, "No, we can't lend you that kind of money." So I had to figure a way to get this done. What I decided to do was, I thought about it, and I said, okay, I'm going to go to my supplier, which was a company in Missouri that made the cards. The cards were probably 94% of my cost, the actual cards in the game, two decks. And I said, I'm going to convince him to give me credit. That way I don't have to pay for the majority of this cost. I called him up. He says, no. Sorry, new customer. We can't give you that kind of credit. I said, but wait a minute. Kmart, I got an order from Kmart, biggest retailer in the country. Surely you can give me credit. He said, no. So then I thought, well, wait a minute. What if I can get Kmart to pay you directly? And then after anything above that, I get paid from them. Would you agree to that? He said, yeah, sure. If you can get Kmart to pay me directly, then I'll give you the credit and we'll make the cards. So I said, okay, great. Now I get on the phone, I call Mr. Christensen, and I said, Mr. Christensen, would you pay, this Matheson company, whatever it was called, would you pay them directly and then pay me the difference? And I'm sitting there sweating, I'm thinking there's no way they're gonna do this. He said, sure, no problem. Now I didn't know this, but basically what we were doing was factoring. Okay, it's common in business to factor receivables. The difference was it wasn't factoring through a finance company, it was factoring through a vendor. I thought I created some new concept, but it was being done. Point is that I was determined to find a way to get this done. And I created this whole concept of getting that done through the vendor. Determination. If I didn't do this, I was out of business. And here's the fifth thing is always learning. I think that it's important to continue to learn. No one knows everything. Most successful entrepreneurs you've heard of, Steve Jobs, Bill Gates, you name it, they all read books frequently. And so do I. I read at least one book weekly. I don't read books, novels, nothing wrong with that. But that's not my thing. If I want a story, I go to a movie, get it done in a couple hours. But when I read, I want to read something that's going to advance my career. So I believe you should always be learning, read books, find mentors you can talk to, get inside information, get network. You know, we got LinkedIn and other resources now, do a lot of networking. None of those resources were available back 30 plus years ago, but I found people that I could network with and get information from. Again, the gentleman in Chicago taught me how to manufacture, how to acquire components. Mr. Christensen, the buyer at Kmart, actually taught me how the sales process works, how to deal with buyers. I took that education and continued to build the business with all the other retailers in the country. And as you may be aware, phase 10 can be bought anywhere in the country. Pretty much anywhere you'll find Uno, you'll see phase 10 a peg or two away from it. And that's because we continue to push forward and continue to develop the brand on a national and an international level. So always learning, always advancing your skill set. Thank you for your attention. I appreciate it. If anybody has, we have maybe 2 minutes. If there's any questions, I'd be glad to answer them. Otherwise, I appreciate your time and listening, and I hope that I've been able to offer you some inside information as to how the game business works and about phase 10. Okay? Oh, I'm sorry, miss?
With today's technology, how would you have done things differently than when you did it when you started? Is there anything differently that you would have done?
Oh, that's a good question. I think now everything's moving to apps. You're probably all aware of this. Retail games, tabletop games, have not suffered in their sales because of apps. However, every time there's a new revolution, a new surge in technology, the tabletop industry gets a little nervous. We got that way back when Atari started introducing their games, you know, many years ago. But we survived. Now we're concerned with the apps. So now what I would do is focus more on apps to start. And by the way, there's a lot more money in apps. To give you an example, you've heard of Candy Crush saga, right? Candy Crush generates for their company, King, about $3 to $4 million every day in sales. If you do the math, you're talking over $1 billion. And most of you probably never buy those, you know, those things you could buy at 99 cents or whatever, right? Anybody ever bought anything on Candy Crush? You probably wouldn't admit it now that I said that. But their recent quarterly statement indicated that about 7% of their monthly active users actually do the purchases, the in-app purchases. But that 7% spend about $20 every month, if you can imagine that. So that's big. Give you another example, Clash of Clans. Anybody heard of Clash of Clans? That's interesting, only a handful of people, literally five. That app generates somewhere along the $1 million to $2 million a day, every day, for its company, developer. I think they're called Supercell. So is there money in apps? Yes, a lot. The only problem with apps is that they tend to be very cyclical. They'll do well, fall off, maybe come back a little, fall off, and eventually they're gone. So they don't have a long lifespan, generally speaking. Whereas with games, parlor games, board games, if they become hits, tend to be around for a long time. Phase 10 is not like most games. The typical game that's introduced in the market, and there are 1,000 plus introduced every year, not to mention the tens of thousands that individual developers create but don't get into the marketplace, the 1,000 or so that are introduced, maybe one or two will last beyond 2 or 3 years. And then maybe of that one or two will go beyond 10 years. It's very rare to get a game to go 30 years. It's very rare. And by the way, our sales are actually increasing with phase 10. We still have a ways to go.
When you first started in your parents' basement, how did you acquire the capital to start producing and manufacturing your own
games? Okay. Let's see. Well, I had worked at Ford Motor Company, and I was very good at saving money. The reason I wanted to leave Ford, I was working 10 hours a day, 6 days a week. Afternoon shift. If you have any idea what that means, I started work at 4:30 in the afternoon. And I'm 19 years old, by the way. 4:30 in the afternoon, I got up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, you can imagine what that does to your social life at 19, 20 years old. I didn't have any time to do anything. My friends were going to parties on Friday and Saturday night. I was working. So I saved money. I saved a couple, $2,000 or $3,000, which is not a whole lot of money. Back then, it was more than it is today. This is 30 plus years ago. And I took that money and started my business with it. Of course, when I got that big order, as I indicated, I didn't have the 30 or plus $1,000 or so I needed. And that's when I created that financing option with my vendor. But I basically worked off my savings. I borrowed $1,000 from my father, and that was it. I just took every dollar I made and put it right back into the business. I didn't draw a salary for the first 3 or 4 years. It took a while for the business to support me. Meanwhile, I worked my business during the afternoon, evening. During the day, I worked whatever job I could find. Anybody else? Sir? Typically, in the game business, your license agreements with large companies work in perpetuity, provided they meet certain benchmarks and hurdles on an annual basis. So, and you have guaranteed minimum royalties. So, in my case, with Mattel, when I negotiated that deal, I had an escalator put into my guaranteed minimum that every year it would go up. And it, provided they did certain shipments and other things, they could continue using the contract indefinitely. The reason that's the case in the toy business is because no one wants to take your intellectual property, get it in the marketplace, and have a 5-year deal with you, and let you walk away after they've made this thing real big in 5 years. So that's not how it works. They want to keep it. If they build it, they want to keep it, provided they do what they're required to do under the license agreement. Sir? As part of the game?
Yeah, like a, kind of throw a little bit of a, I guess, a different thing. I'm not sure if you work with Phase 10 or possibly some other games.
You're right. I am working on something like that right now. Okay. I want to develop, I'm trying to marry the app world with the real world. It's not the trivia game I talked about, but I want to develop a game that requires some use of the app while you're playing the game. You got the social environment with your friends around, you got the app, and then you got a board or something you're playing with. But yes, I have looked on that. Now, Mattel did something like that, excuse me, with their Monopoly game, bombed, okay? So myself and other developers were working on that to try to marry both worlds and hopefully develop it in such a way that you can play on the app solo, and then you can play in a social environment with other people. Okay, not app to app, but app and board, or whatever physical embodiment you might have. Got any ideas? I'd love to talk with you about it. Okay? All right. I'll be on the panel, so if you have any other questions or think about them for the next couple of hours, I'll be glad to answer them. I appreciate your attention. Thank you.